and it only gets tougher from here.
Week. It's been 3 days.
Yeah.
It feels like a week. No doubt, Brad. Today, 135 miles on the way to the famed racetrack in Laguna Seca. Can we go back and look at yesterday really quickly here?
Yeah, what an amazing day of racing.
Julian Alaphilippe, the Frenchman. Now, he's been on the podium multiple times at a couple races that we call monuments in Europe, Liège and the Flèche. He is right now, really, I'd say the biggest star rising out of French cycling. Actually, out of French cycling, he and Brian Coquard, who are here with us, these are the two guys to watch. He moves into the yellow jersey, but certainly the American Peter Stetna was fantastic yesterday. Talk about Pete's ride.
Yeah, Stetna coming back from a terrible injury. Just about a year ago, had a really terrible crash, broke his leg in multiple places. Wasn't sure if he'd return to the sport, but this really cemented his return. The comeback is real for Pete Stetna.
Brad will back me up on this. When we were with him at the Tour of Utah just last August, to get up these exact stairs, as a matter of fact, he had to use a cane, and that cane was not for show.
No.
It was amazing. He was even racing at that point. We had the comeback of Taylor Finney and Pete Stetna happening at that event in Utah. So here he is now, flash forward just another 7 months forward, really, and Pete is dropping the best climbers in the world. And that climb yesterday in Santa Barbara County was the coolest experience I've had in cycling in North America.
Yeah, and I think the hardest climb that we've seen in an American stage race in the last 10 years up Gibraltar Road.
Ever.
Yeah.
Ever. I mean, you can go back to Tour de Pont. You can go back to Tour de Trump. You can go all the way back. Yes, there was a Tour de Trump
at one
point, 1989. It failed.
Didn't go so well.
But anyways, we certainly look forward to today's day is going to be a slog all the way up to Monterey. Now, in our yellow jersey, we've got Julian Alaphilippe. Evan Huffman in the breakaway 2 days in a row. He's ridden in the break now for a total of almost 120 miles at this point in just two stages. Well, we've had three stages. He's ridden the break for two. He's our Lexus King of the Mountain. In the sprint jersey is the world champion, Peter Sagan. And, Brad, that's been really fun to watch Peter this week as well.
Yeah, Peter's going to have some work to do today with a few intermediate sprint lines between here and Laguna Seca. So he'll be trying to pick up maximum points to hold on to that green jersey.
Question for you.
Answer for you.
Does he contest on these bonus sprints today, or does he let the race play out? We know a breakaway will go clear.
Yeah,
it'll be between four and eight guys.
Right.
Does Peter bother?
I think if the group is together, he sprints for it, but I don't think that's going to happen. We're absolutely going to see a break. All those points are going to go to the riders in the breakaway. Peter will not get into a breakaway today. He's not a breakaway rider. He has no reason to ride in the breakaway. He is here to win stages. The green jersey is nice, but he's got to focus on the rest of the week.
Totally agree. He's going to be really happy to see five guys that won't be challenging him down the road go up the road here today. But they'll be looking to bring them back before the finale, because I have a feeling. We were talking with Travis McCabe, a young American sprinter. I think a lot of guys expect today to actually be a sprint. It'll be a reduced group, but I wouldn't be too surprised. Go ahead.
Well, we talked about the Gold Amgen Race Leaders jersey. We talked about the Green Visit California Sprint jersey, the Lexus KOM jersey. Now let's talk about the SRAM Best Young Riders jersey. This was my ride of the day yesterday for Action Hagens Berman's Nielsen Palace, the youngest rider here at the Amgen Tour of California at just 19 years old. This kid rode away from the rest of the field on Gibraltar. I thought he was going to do it. I thought he was going to stay away for the stage win yesterday. Nielsen Palace has a huge future ahead of him, and he'll be wearing our white SRAM Best Young Riders jersey today.
Big star for the future, no question. We had a kickoff press conference up in Santa Rosa. He lives outside of Sacramento talking about Nielsen Palace. And when he showed up for that press conference, I was chatting with him briefly, asking, are you excited about Amgen Tour? And he said, I'm going to be pretty lucky to be in it.
Yeah.
He's on such a strong team. It's like making the starting five on the 1984 Lakers team.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, that is quite a group that we're talking. You're on the Lakers team, but you're not on the starting five. Well, same thing here. Being in the Amgen Tour of California is the biggest possible race experience that these guys are looking for. And Nielsen Paulus is making the most of it, Brad. I'm with you. I thought he was going to stay away as well. But ultimately, Pete Stetna comes over the top of the Paulus attack and then just smothering everybody was Alaphilippe yesterday.
Let's move to our final jersey that we presented yesterday that you'll be meeting here on the Breakaway from Cancer sign-in stage. That's our most courageous Riders jersey, the blue jersey competition, which is really awarded to the rider who most animates the race each day. It's a panel of judges that decide who's going to wear the blue jersey. Yesterday, it was awarded to Greg Daniel. What a ride he had in the breakaway for the Action Hagens-Berman team. Now, that's Nielsen Paulus's teammate, so that gives you an idea of just how aggressive this Action Hagens-Berman team has been. But Greg had a great ride yesterday, and he'll be wearing the blue Breakaway from Cancer Most Courageous Rider jersey today.
Got to give it up for Tanner Putt in the breakaway as well yesterday. I think he was the final guy in the consideration for that jersey. Hey, Brad, did you know this is a Peregrine Falcon reserve?
Yeah.
You did?
Yeah.
All right. Keeping our eye open.
I'm on the listserv.
Right on. There you go. And welcome to San Luis Obispo County and beautiful Morro Bay. Morro Bay's iconic Morro Rock stands imposingly at 576 feet tall at the harbor's entrance. The rock is a natural preserve and serves as a sanctuary for over 200 species of birds. The harbor is home to barking sea lions, sea otters, and a host of marine life. For more information on ways to play in Morro Bay, head on over to the Visitor Center at 695 Harbor Street or log on to morrobay.org. You can do that on your mobile phone or smart device or your flip phone.
Whatever you got
right,
these days.
Whatever you've got.
Your tablet. Yeah, the European riders are really excited to come to Morro Bay this morning. Finally get to see the ocean here at the Amgen Tour of California. Get a little coastal start before we head to Laguna Seca today.
Do you know what attacking strike speed is for a Peregrine Falcon? 200 miles an hour.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Even faster than the riders at the Amgen Tour.
Yeah, we won't quite see speeds like that today, but it'll be about 175 miles an hour short.
So as you're here with us at our Breakaway from Cancer sign-in stage, I think all the riders are going to wait till the last minute. They're going to be out there for 6 hours on the bike racing today. It's going to be a 10-hour block of work, really, when you look at to race today's stage. You were eating breakfast 3 hours before the start, so that the digestion process is completely underway. Today is a 7,000-calorie day if you're a 150-pound racer, and that's actually pretty heavy for the guys that, not heavy, but certainly use a 150-pound athlete, 7,000 calories just to get you through the day today.
Yeah, you talk to a lot of these riders after stage 4, 5, 6 when we start getting to the end of the tour and you start talking about how they're feeling and the fatigue. They say, my legs are fine, I feel great on the bike, but I'm so tired of eating.
Right, exactly. And we're getting to that point already. We started in San Diego. That was an amazing way to kick off this 11th edition of the Amgen Tour. We had the world champion in the rainbow jersey winning a sprint right there. It was just iconic. Guys, heads up. The BMC bus, I think, is coming through.
Just going to park it right there. Just leave it there.
These buses are notorious for getting stuck underneath the finish structures, and we're not going to let that happen.
Good morning.
Good morning, guys. Yes.
So just leave it there.
In that bus, we would imagine would be Danny Lovice, Mickey Schar, Taylor Finney, Greg Van Avermaet, whose birthday was yesterday, and obviously Rowan Dennis with that squad. So that is like the New York Yankees or the L.A. Dodgers or Red Sox of major cycling when you talk about the BMC team. Cannondale rode the front a lot yesterday. As a matter of fact, it was green pretty much on the TV screen for the last 2 hours race yesterday.
A little bit of bad luck for that squad. The yellow jersey yesterday, Ben King, who had transitioned his role into helping his teammate on the Cannondale squad, actually dropped a chain just at the bottom of the climb about 500 meters before they started the Gibraltar Road climb. Ben King unfortunately dropped the chain, wasn't able to get back up to the front, so a little bit of bad luck for that squad, but they had an okay day yesterday. Not great, but they're not out of the running yet.
No, we've got a long way to go. It's interesting. Yesterday's stage, so important, but it doesn't define the rest of the race. We've got a lot of riders who are still within striking distance. A time trial on Friday that's going to be critical. So what you're really looking at now is we saw who the best climbers are with us at the Amgen Tour of California, and that is indisputably Julian Alaphilippe. No question. The way that he made that, the last attack on Peter Stetna was vicious. Yeah. He just surged away and ended up for his second win here at the Amgen Tour. He won on Mount Baldy as well. The three most iconic climbing days in the history of this event, I believe, would be Diablo, Baldy, and Gibraltar yesterday. And he's won two of those 3 days. And he's not our king of the mountain. Isn't that amazing? Evan Huffman of the rally team, 65,000 feet of climbing over almost 800 miles of racing, but it comes at you. It's like jab after jab after jab out there. And Huffman, I have a feeling, in pretty good shape to hold on to our Lexus King of the Mountain jersey all the way to Sacramento. But it's going to take everything they've got.
Yeah, he's going to have to spend a lot of time off the front of this bike race if he wants to hold on to that Lexus KOM jersey, the points-based competition for the polka dot jersey.
Known for their bike-friendly nature, San Luis Obispo County and Morro Bay encourage joyriding at every turn. Morro Bay has protected bike paths throughout the town and along the bay to the rock, as well as amazing coastal range mountain biking. However, you like to cycle, Morro Bay has you covered. Discover the area on two wheels and download the city's free bike map on morrobay.org or head over. More information is at 695 Harbor Street. We'll be heading over there.
Well, when it comes to food, the Bounty of Morro Bay in San Luis Obispo County can't be beat. Dig into Morro Bay's ocean-to-table cuisine, from oysters to fresh fish and abalone. Find just the thing to please your palate with Morro Bay's historic fishing roots. It's famous for its practices in fresh seafood fare. Today's sustainable fishing practices are on display in the harbor, where fishermen can be seen hauling in the day's fresh catch. For more information on ways to taste Morro Bay, head to the Visitor Center over at 695 Harbor Street or morrobay.org.
To send you out in the ocean, have you hand catch us a little Pacific salmon.
Yeah, I'm in. Right. Some oysters for breakfast.
You got long arms. You're quick. Got a good brain on you, Brad.
I could do it.
Right on. So, hey, today's stage, what do you think? We've learned already Ben King winning stage two going into Santa Clarita. We know the breakaway can work. Takes a lot of courage. Today is one of those kind of days. You know, the last time we kind of did this route, it was flipped. We went from Seaside, so that's almost Monterey, down to San Luis Obispo. It was also about 140 miles that day. The conditions were a little colder and a lot rainier that day.
Yeah.
Took the riders 7 hours to complete the stage. We actually, the only time in the history of American racing at this level, have I seen a guy do this. Jackson Stewart, with the BMC team now as the director, was riding in the breakaway. They had a four-minute advantage. He pulls over to the side of the road and says, I quit. I'm done. It was so cold. Their hands, they couldn't operate the brake levers or the shifters anymore. The team directors and mechanics in the cars were taking off their own shirts and jackets with the warm jacket and handing that out to riders and taking their wet jacket back and putting it on to warm that jacket up for the next guy. It was kind of like Jim Morrison's, is anyone going to get out of here alive when you're in that team car at some point? So that was quite a day of racing. Today will be decidedly different. We're going the other direction. It's not raining. It's still going to be epic here at the Amgen Tour.
Yeah, the big play will be on the breakaway. We'll be monitoring those breaks all day because they're going to go. I say today it comes back together. I think we see it will be a reduced group, maybe 70, 80 riders on the way into Laguna Seca. But you've been there before. You've seen this circuit at Laguna Seca. It's not an easy final 5K. There is a lot of ups and downs on the way into the finish line, far from your classic flat sprint stage.
Much like around here, actually, the hills might not be so long, but they're severe. And when you see these attacks, it's a searing attack from a guy like Alaphilippe. When it's that steep, it turns into this bizarre, you know, watch for a guy like Greg Van Avermaet as well. I mean, the Belgian classics that these guys are so good at are known for 1 kilometer long, 8% to 12% grades, even steeper than what they saw yesterday. But you got to remember, yesterday was 10K of 8%. So in that 6 miles, you actually went up 3,000 feet.
Still hurts to hear about.
That's halfway, more than halfway from sea level to Denver.
Yeah.
In 6 miles. It's intense. It's crazy what they're doing out here. We've got today 140 of the world's best cyclists. Let me touch on some big names for you. Brad, let's go back and forth. I'll tell you that Brad Wiggins is here, Tour de France winner and the greatest English Olympian of all time.
I'll go with his countryman, Mark Cavendish, running for the Dimension Data team.
Fair play. I will take the Norwegian Alexander Kristoff of the Katusha team. He won more important races in the world last year than anyone.
All right, I'll go John Degenkolb up next.
Perfect. I'll take Rowan Dennis, former world hour record holder. He's won Tour of Alberta, he's won USA Pro Challenge, and he's worn the yellow jersey as the fastest stage winner at the Tour de France history.
You know, this race starts in an hour. If we keep this up, we're not going to make it.
That's how many great stars there are. Taylor Finney is in this race as well. He's the American that went to the Olympic Games in his senior year of high school.
Yeah.
Back in 2008 in Beijing. He's a 6-time world champion. His mom is the first ever Olympic gold medalist in this sport. 1984. That's amazing to me that women did not have a professional road race at the Olympics until 84.
Yeah.
But Connie won. Another American second that day, Rebecca Twigg. So, Brad, we can stop the game.
Okay, good.
You won. We tied.
Actually, you had the
we
last
tied.
One.
Right.
But
okay.
I'm Sammy Sanchez, Olympic gold medalist.
2008 Beijing game Olympic gold medalist.
Just going to keep slipping them in.
And they're all, I mean, the last four
they're
guys,
all on the red bus.
I know. Good morning, guys. Welcome to Morro Bay.
This was kind of atypical to have the team buses here in front of the stage. Usually these guys are off in a parking lot somewhere. They don't get to see the morning show. So I don't know if this is good or bad for their morale this morning.
I feel like we're being pretty heavily scrutinized, though.
Dave, talk about what goes on these buses. What are the riders doing now, about an hour before start?
The most unique bus in the sport is the one right there, Team Novo Nordisk. Every rider on that team is a type 1 diabetic. So they obviously have some special attention that they pay to their blood sugar at this point in the morning. I'm sure we all have a friend out there who's diabetic, and you kind of know how that, maybe some of us more than others, how that process works. But monitoring your blood sugar is very important. They have a great American mechanic named Andy Stone. He's right over there now. He runs their service course out of Georgia. They're an American-based team, but they race most of the time over in Europe. And then United Healthcare here. That's a team that you would say is based in the U.S., riders from around the world.
Yeah.
Over the last 10 years, they've been a dominant force racing at events like the Amgen Tour of California.
Yeah, I'd say they do about half their time over in Europe, half their time racing here in the United States. United Healthcare is what's called a pro-continental team. We always compare it to baseball, where you have the MLB, which is what we call the World Tour, teams like BMC. Then you have pro-continental, which are kind of your feeder teams. It's the next level down, and we have a good mix of teams here at the Amgen Tour of California.
And how about the continental team and their rider, Nielsen Palace yesterday. So the best ride of the day does not always come from the biggest teams. That's what I love about the mix that we have here. You're right. It's like a lot of major league teams, a couple triple A's, and then a smattering of double A.
One or
guys.
Two. Yeah. But man, so, when that double A rider has that performance, that's a game changer. Make your career.
Absolutely, and that's how you get on to the major league team, is by putting together a great ride like Nielsen Paulus. Nielsen Paulus has just written his ticket for a European World Tour ride with what he did yesterday.
Oh, no doubt. He'll have his email box will be filling up here pretty quickly, as he's going to have a lot of folks knocking on his door. Although, I got to say, at 19 years old, I wouldn't be surprised if Nielsen does another year or two with the Action Hagens Berman team. We're starting to see a lot of riders that don't want to go to the World Tour level too early. They're waiting to make that jump because you really don't want to get burnt out. It is so tough your first year in Europe. The first year you go over to race the World Tour, you're basically just getting your head kicked in over and over, day after day after day, even a kid like Nielsen Paulus.
Talk to Evan Huffman about that.
Yeah.
Hey, why don't you just Snapchat him?
Snapchat.
Yeah. Whatever you're doing with that.
You're going to figure it out. We're gonna get you on it eventually. One day. Joanna and Allison are...
They're going to Snapchat him.
Our Michelob Ultra podium hostesses have been trying to get Dave up to speed on the latest social media. It is, it's not going well.
I'm now on Fling.
We're making progress.
Yeah. So we are so focused on this bike race. It really is amazing, isn't it? The whole world kind of disappears around you as you're in this amazing bubble. And we've had three great days. World champion Peter Sagan winning. That was in San Diego. Then we had the breakaway with the American champion Ben King winning. And then yesterday, this phenomenal day of racing, one of the most beautiful days in all of American racing history.
Do want to point out one thing here on the sign-in board. We have our first crossed-out name of the day. That is going to be Pete Kenya, who went down in a crash yesterday for Team Sky, the current British Road National Champion, with a broken collarbone after a little mix-up at the back of the field yesterday. Just a touch of wheels. It wasn't really a high-speed crash or anything like that, but it is so easy to break that collarbone in this sport. What happens, you put your hands out when you crash, and that kind of sends the shockwave up your arm and into the collarbone. That's one of the most common injuries we see in the sport of cycling, the clavicles.
The collarbone is like a fuse. It breaks, so more important bodies in your bones right. in your body don't break. So tough to have Peter go through that. So we are going to be joined today by Missy Swanson. She is a cancer survivor. We're going to enjoy having a chance with her to find out how her survivorship is going and talk about the team around her that's helping make that happen. So that'll be, once again, all of the riders will be signing in here today, and I'm sure we'll have...
All except one.
Peter. Right, right.
So far, we may have riders who choose not to start this morning, whether it's illness or injury or just fatigue after the first 3 days.
You know, I would say yesterday a lot of guys came out maybe a little better shape than maybe they thought they would.
Yeah.
I think that the conditions were nice for racing yesterday. It wasn't an extreme day. We saw, Kiryenka, we saw a crash a couple days ago, but he got back up and dusted himself off. So it's a... Knock on wood, right? But pretty uneventful outside of Peter Kenog. That crash happened at the back of the group yesterday. Actually, I saw a video of Chris Putt of the Jelly Belly team just barely getting
some
around
serious
that
serious bike handling skills.
Yeah, it looked like Peter Sagan there. So we... So, hey, let's bring up... Do we have a microphone for Missy? Great. Come on up, Missy. This is Missy Swanson joining us. So, Missy, I'm guessing Morro... Step right up. I'm guessing that Morro Bay is your home?
I live in San...
Right into it there. Good.
I live in San Luis Obispo, but I'm out here paddling on the bay a couple times a week with my Dragon Boat team.
Oh, nice. Nice. Right here? Do you guys go out? Back over
right
that
way. Right behind
me
in the bay, so...
Oh, nice. How did you get into dragon boating?
Well, actually, our Dragon Boat team was formed for breast cancer survivors. And as a survivor, I was encouraged to go out with the group because it really helps with the physical activity and the emotional and the support. And it's just a really great way to get out and get your exercise. So I joined the team and never looked back. So
it's always looked to me like there's a real, there's a real... survivorship and surfing or oarship or whatever you call it out there share that same, it's a collection of people that really seem, it bonds people together, maybe the best way to put it.
It definitely does. So, and being on the Dragon Boat, being a part of a team, the teamwork is just really one of the most important things to be successful on the water, and so it really bonds us.
Yeah, that well put, absolutely. Mm-hmm. As a breast cancer survivor, it seems like that has been one, as we've talked about it, that man, if there was ever a getting tested early and often, with the men, it definitely prostate and testicular, mm-hmm. and with the women, breast cancer, if you could just, you know, get over the stigma of the testing, it's such a good thing for everybody. And I think we're kind of doing that as a society. What do you think?
Absolutely. I mean, early detection is one of the most important things. So I was caught early, and so here I am today.
Yeah, great. And so when we talk about it, and we meet a lot of cancer survivors along the way here, what do you like to do, Bird of Survivorship arena here, what do you like to tell people who you're being introduced to, have just been told that they've been diagnosed with cancer? Where do you like to start with that? It's tough, I guess, person by person, isn't it?
Yeah, it is person by person. One of the things I tell people is as you're going through treatment, it's really, really important to maintain an exercise routine, because the treatments, you kind of lose control of your body, but by the exercise, you're regaining that control as you go through the motions. So it gives you a sense of purpose going through
sure.
it, so
maybe
you're
a little,
in control.
A little accountability too, maybe, huh? Like if you don't show up to meet the survivors, they're like, hey, where are you?
Yeah.
Let's get you out here.
Yeah,
right?
Many times people can't paddle during treatment because, you know, they're going through treatment, but we're still there for them as a team, and it's like, well, just do something. Go for a walk, you know, go for a run. I started running when I was going through treatment because I couldn't go to the gym. There were just too many germs.
Right. Yeah. Still holds true, I think. when you were diagnosed and began the journey there, who or what did you draw strength from? Was there a particular, was it your faith? Was it your family, friends, all of that?
A little bit of everything. Of course, my family was there with me through the whole thing.
Uh-huh.
I was also involved with a church youth group, and they were so supportive, just the staff members and the students. And I also had a young survivors support group that was all women around my age that had careers and families. And so we really bonded. They really got me through it.
Did you watch the race when it came to San Luis Obispo back? I think it was 2008, maybe 2009. It's probably eight.
Yeah, I went to the time trials in
okay.
Solvay.
Oh,
so,
nice. Those were always really fun.
Yeah, my girls from my support group came and kidnapped me right after my radiation
really?
Treatment and took me out there to go see the time trials, and it was just phenomenal.
So I'm guessing then you're well past your five-year mark for survivorship?
Seven.
Awesome. So. Good for you. I mean, we've always heard how important that five-year mark is. It really kind of, you've turned a corner, I think, at that point. So
yeah.
So seven is even two times more awesome than five.
I'll take it.
Right. No, good for you. And we obviously, and hope you have a great day here watching the races. Stay with us on stage. You're going to see, I don't know if you have any particular, how closely you follow cycling, but if there's any star you want to meet, we're happy to make that happen.
Okay, great. Thank
yeah,
you.
Yeah, right on. Cool. Well, once again, that is Missy Swanson joining us here on stage. Cancer survivor and definitely a beautiful smile and great attitude.
Thank you.
All right, Brad. Well, there you go. Missy Swanson, certainly a very good example of what survivorship, and I like her talking about the team around her as
yeah.
well.
Yeah, absolutely.
Survivors is, I see they're doing a little, see what they're doing
yeah,
there?
I think you and I should get on a dragon boat.
Yeah.
Missy, can you set that up for us? Dave and I want to try out a dragon boat. How do we do that? We'll do it after the stage today. All right, perfect.
Right.
We get some cyclists actually, out there. I'll bet you they would be good dragon boat sailors, rowers.
Oh, cyclists would be the worst dragon boaters ever, right? I mean, they've got no arms. Everything is in.
Yeah, oh, yeah. No, you do not want a cyclist.
No,
upper body strength is not a strong category.
I would almost guarantee you that your women's over 60 survivors team would put these guys to shame.
These guys have trouble opening a jar of peanut butter.
Right, exactly.
Let alone rowing a dragon
boat.
But
hey, that's what you get when you're riding your bike for 500 miles a week out there right now. And that's 800 miles in 8 days is what our field will be contesting here at the Amgen Tour of California. Go ahead, Brad.
Speaking of dragon boats, San Luis Obispo County and Morro Bay's temperate year-round climate allows for outdoor enthusiasts to stay active with hiking, biking, surfing, sailing, kayaking, stand-up paddleboarding, and golfing. Whatever you're in the mood for, Morro Bay has something to offer the thrill seeker in you. For more information on the ways to stay active in Morro Bay, head on over to the Visitor Center on Harbor Drive or visit morrobay.org.
I just have a whole bunch of things great to say about Morro Bay as well, which is...
We're going to have to come back to Morro Bay.
Yeah,
loving
no,
it
absolutely.
Here.
The first time the race has ever been here, San Diego first this year as well. But we've been to San Luis Obispo before, and I actually Pismo and Avila a few times along the way. But, beautiful, beautiful place. Have not seen a barking sea lion yet.
We're working on that for you.
Yeah. But the podium, Michelob Ultra podium ambassadors have seen a killer whale. Yes. Actually, Joanna, while on vacation in Mexico at one point in her life, was thrown off of, this is a true story, thrown off of a banana boat with her cousin and hit a whale. Literally hit a whale.
True story.
And then fainted. The whale or you? Yes, Joanna then fainted.
The whale was fine.
Yes.
We're happy to report.
How do you know the whale was fine, though?
We checked on him. We did a welfare check a few weeks later.
Last ever time on a banana boat. Yep, last time.
First and only.
Yes. So, actually, we certainly, when you have a day like today, the riders don't get to appreciate enough what Morro Bay is like. You'll have some of these guys, you'll be like, what do you think of that 576-foot-tall rock? And they'll be like,
what rock?
There was a rock?
Yeah.
Never? Huh. But right now, team meetings going on, talking about tactic and strategy for the day. Clearly, with this race being so far from over, you've got to be attentive. You can't miss a step on a day like today. If you have a breakaway go up the road and it's got Peter Stetna in it, guess what happens? The alarm bells are ringing.
Yeah, each day you'll see the riders going through what's called the road book or the tech guide with their teams. It basically has a preview of the day's stage with a map, an elevation profile, a cue sheet with each turn, and they kind of try and anticipate how the race is going to go down, especially the final few K. That's typically the most important thing for guys like the sprinters. They'll be watching those last five or six turns that you have to make in the run into the finish, trying to visualize it so they know what's coming at the finish. You don't want to have any surprises out there.
Even more. They'll have a staff member at the finish go out with a windsock and take a look at not only how hard it's blowing, but where it's coming from, relay that information back to the director who's in the team car, who then will be, riders have radios at this level. That director, you can't call the rider on the cell phone.
No.
Right.
It's tough to swipe your iPhone to open up the call.
It is. But you can have the director communicate, guys, what you'd hear. Guys.
Yeah.
It's to the right, be to the right, through the second roundabout, always to the right, guys. Always do the right.
Your team director is impeccable.
Yes.
Very
good.
But
that is what you're hearing over in your earpiece. And all you really know is get right. Just get to the right.
Stay to the right.
And then the other thing they always say, move up, guys. Move up, guys. And that's pretty much what you've got.
They'll also use those radios to help other riders to alert the team. If one of their star riders has a problem, they'll actually send riders back out of the back of the group to pace that rider back up. So sometimes you're riding at the front, and then you hear, get to the back, Mark has crashed, or Mark has a flat tire, and then you got to go back and help.
At the stage in Santa Rosa a couple years ago, Peter Sagan had a flat tire with 8K to go, and that's exactly it. Guys, get to the back. Peter, flat tire, they know that. They all move to the back and help pace him back up. He actually won that stage that day, and that is pretty much unheard of.
Yeah, pretty amazing.
Yeah, and a lot of that, though, is what, at that time, that was the Cannondale team. Now Peter riding for Tinkoff as the current world champion, and we'll get to see him today in our Visit California Green Points Leaders jersey.
Actually, pretty similar situation on stage one, maybe stage two, where Peter had a double flat inside the last 10K.
Yeah, that usually a double flat means you went into a deep pothole, doesn't it? Because that you probably pinch flatted. It's not like he got two shards or shards of glass.
What are the chances?
Yeah, that would be pretty rare. So probably, every now and then it can get tough out there. Thank you, Joanna. We really are lucky to work with such consummate professionals, Allison and Joanna, who have been with the race now collectively. Between the two of them, we've got 14 editions, I believe, now. It's pretty amazing. There's a couple areas we always talk about how great the Tour de France is. Tour de France has got nothing on the Amgen Tour of California in this category.
Oh, we certainly have the most beautiful podium hostesses. I don't think that's up for question.
And they're smart as a whip.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah, it's one of the great things about this race. The people you meet along the way, it's always quite a journey, isn't it, young man?
Yeah, although we've had this lovely duo with us for 5 years now.
We're a veteran team at this point.
Well-oiled machine.
Right. So, Brad, I think we won't have any riders signing in here until the last possible moment on a day like today. As with the weather the way it is. Sounds like you've got something to take care of here.
Yeah, we're going to be meeting some of our LOC members here in just a bit. As every day, we like to recognize all the people that help bring the Amgen Tour of California to town.
Today, we're heading up to Laguna Seca. It's crazy to think that the four-time Paris-Roubaix winner in our field, and he's also got three Flanders as well. These are the biggest races on the planet. Raced here in 2001. At the very beginning of his career, he came and did an event that's held every year up in Monterey, or actually, I guess, Laguna Seca, out between Monterey and Salinas. There, not technically in Monterey. You ever ridden 100 miles in a day on your bike? That's quite a challenge. Wouldn't you call that a landmark challenge?
Yeah, absolutely. I sat down in the shower after that ride.
With a beer?
Yeah.
Right. So, actually, you were probably 14 when you tried to do something like that.
Actually,
right?
Yeah. Yep. That's early in my career.
In all seriousness, for a lot of people in cycling, just the world of cycling, that's something that you can really hang your hat on. You've ridden your bike 100 miles in a day. These guys, Brad, are going to be doing that part of the day in under 4 hours out here today. That is just another... when you're riding your bike 30 hours a week, and that's what they're doing when they're in a big training block, this is just another day at the office in a weird way. Hey, I wanted to give a quick mention to this man, Butch Balzano, cancer survivor. And right after the race, Butch is going to be going back in and getting more chemo done for his throat. Butch, you are our hero. Thank you so much. Butch is here working and running the SRAM NRS team.
Yeah, Butch.
And he's doing it with, like, have you ever seen that man anything but gracious and kind and with a smile on his face? We didn't even know that Butch was dealing with this cancer until one of his friends told us. So that Butch would have, he's going to kill me later. But that's
I got wheels to change now.
Yeah, right.
Butch has saved a lot of bike races for a lot of riders. He's in that SRAM neutral support car that you see parked just up the road. That's a red station wagon with the bikes on top. If a rider has a mechanical problem during the race, Butch and Jose Alcala, some of the best mechanics in the business, are in that car. They'll be able to give those riders spare wheels, extra bike if they need it, if they have something wrong with the frame or drivetrain. But most of the time, it's tire changes, and it is crucial to have a good tire change and a good neutral support team behind the race.
It's like NASCAR. They can change out a wheel in 10 seconds. Also want to thank Code 4, our sound guys, who do a really, really good job for us. Appreciate that. They're not listening. No, we really appreciate you guys for all of your hard work. And as we, Brad, I have a feeling, seriously, we are going to have 140 riders in one huge group coming up to sign in.
There'll be a crush of riders. We're going to do our best to grab interviews with as many of those riders as we can. Our apologies if we miss your favorite rider. We're trying to get to as many big names as possible here, as we do have about an hour for sign-in here on the Breakaway from Cancer sign-in stage, although I think you're right. They're probably waiting in the bus, getting the team meetings out of the way, maybe having an extra coffee or two this morning with 140 miles on tap.
Yeah. And could you blame them?
No.
No, not at all. Because once you come out here, once you come out of the team bus,
it's on.
Everything changes.
Your day has started.
Absolutely.
Like walking into the office. There's no going back.
So longest stage of this year's Amgen Tour of California, and certainly one that's going to be a part of the storyline of this race in the overall battle. Today really is one of these days, Brad, where you can equally weight the overall GC battle and the battle for a stage win. It's like if you look at the Tour de France, when they're racing on the Champs-Élysées, they're no longer racing for the GC overall. It's about this huge win, putting your arms in the air as you come over the line. The GC win is a lot more subtle, isn't it? But it's also way more impactful in a rider's career.
Yeah, you're pretty much always racing in the GC. If you're a
and you might never even win a stage to win
absolutely.
The overall. Yeah. Right. It's just the lowest amount of time. Brad explains this really well. But it's like golf in that every day we take your time. We add the times up. And whoever has the least amount is the guy who's made his way around California the fastest. So there are some bonuses that you can pick up that subtracts time from your overall time. If you win a stage, they take 10 seconds off. But in basically, it's just who gets around the state the fastest, or actually not the fastest, in the least amount of time.
Yeah, the winner's time right. will be something like 25 to 30 hours, I'm going to guess, somewhere
typically,
in there.
Right? I mean, usually it's 82 hours of racing at the Tour de France.
Yeah.
To make up all of those days. And here we race for 780 miles, basically, over 8 days. But remember, one of those days, really, one of the most complicated days and stressful days of this race is only about 15 miles.
Yeah,
that's the individual time trial.
Arguably the most important day for the GC guys after yesterday, because now we've had the shakeout. Now we know who the real contenders are for our Gold Amgen Race Leaders jersey. And there's not many opportunities to pick up major chunks of time. You can win a stage here and there, but you're not going to win by more than 15 or 20 seconds. They're not going to let a big GC guy get too far up the road. But on the time trial day, there's nothing they can do to reel you in. So the good time trialists in the hunt for GC are going to have a very, very good tour here at the Amgen Tour California.
I feel like I have never positioned myself on the stage better than today.
Why do you say that?
Because you've got your back to the Falcons. I can see them coming in.
Get out of the way.
There's one circling right now, and it looks like a monster. It looks like a pterodactyl.
Great. Great.
Yeah.
Now
I'll let you know.
Now we're going to spend the rest of the morning nervous.
I can just give you a hand signal to have you dive to either direction where I'm reading the Falcon coming in.
I assume I'll just see you diving first.
You'll
and I'm
go
just
the
going
same
where
way.
You go.
All right. That's a good technique right there. You've thought this through.
Yeah. I highly doubt that your first instinct is protect Brad when you see a peregrine falcon coming at you at 200 miles an hour.
It's all about me, and then let the chips fall where they may.
Yeah, that's not the first thing that comes into your head. I'm fully aware of that and prepared to adjust.
What can a teammate do to help an overall leader on a day like today, Brad?
Yeah, it's going to be about clothing, it's going to be about food, and it's going to be about water. The team leader should never have to go back to the team cars. You see the vehicles pulling in behind the buses. Each team has two cars in the race caravan that follows the race. They're going to have extra food in there. They're going to have water bottles and spare clothing as well if a rider wants to change during the day. The team leader never has to go back to the car. They've got people that do that. So they're going to send one of their other seven teammates back to the car. They'll load up with food and bottles, actually stuffing them down the jerseys, anywhere you can carry extra weight for those riders, and then they bring it back up and deliver it to their star rider who can stay at the front of the field. It really is a great show of teamwork when you see a guy rolling through the field with nine bottles stuffed down his jersey and in the back pockets. Any extra weight that they can carry, they take it on and then pass it out to the teammates.
Yeah, this is when they're not getting it out of the feed zone that they'll see along the way. It's sort of like Battlestar Galactica with this. Like you got the one mothership here, and then you've got a couple other smaller ships, and then the cyclists, which are the fighting jets.
I was excited to see where you're going with that.
Yeah,
did that work? That's a new one.
Yeah,
I've never heard that one before.
And I was wondering if you'd ever even heard of Battlestar Galactica.
Yeah.
You have.
I'm not that young.
Right. I think they remade it for Netflix or something, didn't they? So right now, all of these vehicles are filled with eight riders who are probably watching the last half hour of Good Morning America, I would guess, at this point.
Catching up on Battlestar Galactica.
Well, it looks like a weather front hitting Minnesota right now. But actually, probably what they're probably watching is the Giro d'Italia, to tell you the truth, that's taking place right now in Italy. The stage would have, at this time of day, would have just ended.
I think probably just wrapping up.
As a matter of fact, Brad, that's not a bad guess as to why we don't have one cyclist in sight. They're probably watching their teammates in the Giro.
Good to see Morro Bay PD lining up for the race today. They're going to be doing the 140-mile jaunt down to Laguna Seca.
Guys, you're going to want to get going because the race is really motor. So
I'd probably take those bags off the back, too.
Yeah.
That's nothing but dead weight.
The pack?
Yeah.
How do you know what's in there?
Well,
it could be sport beans.
It's a lot of sport beans.
Yeah, it's a long ride.
Yeah.
What do the riders eat?
Well, the Jelly Belly riders, who we'll meet here in a little bit, they like their sport beans. It's really easy to digest stuff. That's the biggest thing for the riders.
Rice cakes are huge.
A lot of rice cakes.
About a few years ago, actually, they were with us last year. Scratch Labs helped introduce the homemade rice cake. And it really is rice and then You can do whatever you want with it. Some guys will go with the savory kind of route and throw some soy sauce or bacon, that kind of thing. Other guys will go a sweet or a mix of that. When you're eating 7,000 calories a day, as Brad said, you get tired of eating. And you also get really tired of sticky, sweet stuff.
Yeah.
At some point, you're craving that the change.
And it's always funny seeing riders go through the feed zone. They grab what are called musette bags. They're these little canvas bags full of all kinds of different food.
Rider alert, rider alert.
All right, I'll hold that thought.
Because this is going to be a great guy to talk to as well. They call him the Pit Bull, Andrew Talansky of the Cannondale team. He lives in Napa, California. Originally, Brad, I'll put you on the spot. Do you know where Andrew grew up? What state? There's another rider in this race who grew up there as well. Florida.
Florida.
Yeah. Pretty unique, actually.
A lot of good climbing down there in Florida.
We'll have to ask about that. Andrew Talansky, one of the best climbers in the world. Andrew, it really doesn't matter where you grow up as far as if you can be a good climber. It's physiological, not environmental, correct?
I think to a point, you know, I moved away from Florida, you know, a couple of years after I'd gotten on the bike. So it was, I think, early enough in my career I could still get up some hills.
And so, hey, you and your wife, Katie, look like you've made quite a life for yourselves in Napa. What is it that you love so much about California?
It's home. I mean, I might have grown up in Florida, but I've always had family out in California. I came out here to surf growing up, and I love the ocean. I love the coast. I love places like where we're starting today in Morro Bay. I love where we're going, and it's just there's no other place like it.
Talking with Andrew Talansky, one of the top Americans in the sport today, Andrew, where you ride up in around Santa Rosa, we're talking about the stage 7 of this event. It's absolutely stunning. It's absolutely gorgeous. And I would have to say, I don't know if you know, there's a peregrine falcon reserve that we've got here. You're not allowed to climb on these rocks because of the falcons there. And I mean, this is just magical. When we had a barking sea otter that was coming up towards your team bus, they had to corral that guy away. I mean, that's not exactly your everyday start, is it?
No, it's great. It's beautiful, man. When we were driving in here, you know, it's kind of a sleepy little, you know, now we're in Northern California coastal town, and kind of all the way from Santa Barbara through Mendocino and north of that, the coast is beautiful. I mean, the route we're going to take today is, I've never gotten to train on it very much, and I've certainly never gotten to ride on it in a race with no cars on it, so I'm looking forward to it.
So outside of cycling, what other kinds of racing do you like? Are you a motorsports guy?
I like Formula One.
There you go. All right. Maybe next career for you. Thanks, Andrew. Andrew, you, like, we haven't spent enough of your money on sports, right? So this is. So that was Andrew Talansky, a big, big star with us at the Amgen Tour this year. All right. This is going to be fun. Bringing up now Lawrence Stendam. Lawrence, great ride yesterday, ending up 6th on the stage, but let's forget about that for a second. How cool is Morro Bay? You're an outdoors guy, man. Your family loves camping. We should hook you guys up with a week here in Morro Bay camping with your camper van.
To be honest, I was here last October.
Awesome.
So we camped on Highway 1, we camped in San Luis Obispo, we passed here. It's all beautiful, but now we don't see anything, actually.
Yeah, exactly. We'll have to ask people, I'm sure. Yeah, pretty foggy, for sure. So, hey, this is a very unique situation. Lawrence has been given a lot of trust by his top-level Giant Alpecin team. They're allowing him to live in Santa Cruz and race. Yesterday, it must have been very, very nice to finish the day and be able to say, thank you, guys, and you can now tell I'm doing my work.
Yeah, because people think in Santa Cruz you're just for holiday, you know, and it's good to show them I'm training too, instead of just barbecuing and having some brewery beers.
So, Lawrence, with so much technology, you look and you know the watts that you're making, but still there's nothing like proving it, is there, with the guys actually racing?
No, that's true. You need to, the watts are the watts. At the end, it's Alaphilippe who wins the race, you know, and it's all about that. So, I'm a little bit old school, not looking too much on the watts, and just training my ass off and hope to be good in the race.
Well, it looks like you've been doing your work, no doubt. And hey, how beautiful was the finish yesterday? I'd never seen anything like that. Seeing the ocean from the climb, unbelievable.
I only saw it when I went to the RV, because uphill I was too focused, but it was really nice views. It was good to see, and I hope the race once enters Santa Cruz Mountains one year, because there you can see some other nice stuff.
I'm sure we will. Well, last question for you. Today, all the GC guys, the guys that made it into the top 10, do you take a day off and let the other guys race and wait for a little bit later, or is it going to be a dangerous day today again?
As a GC rider, you have to pay attention every day, but I think tomorrow with the Salt Lake Tahoe stage is going to be a big day.
Great. Thank you, Lawrence. Lawrence Tenda. Brad, this is a people's champion if there ever was one when you talk about Lawrence.
Yeah, Mr. California now.
Yeah, he is absolutely everything that we were hoping that professional racing could bring with Lawrence to California this year. We had him doing a Zwift ride with us that was super fun. Zwift has been a great partner.
I know what Lawrence was watching on the bus. He was watching the San Jose Sharks game.
He's a really, Lawrence is as much Californian as Dutch these days. So, Brad, more guys starting to sign in now. I'm really surprised to see no jackets on the guys.
Team Novo Nordisk. I was cold just looking at them.
He's like, not only are they just wearing a shirt, it's mesh.
Yeah, there's not much underneath. Doesn't leave much to the imagination, if you know what I mean.
No. Hey, it's Joe Lewis. So, good morning, Joe, the Holowesco Citadel rider. It looks like one of the most fun teams to be on. You guys are a band of brothers out there, Joe. How's it going this week?
Dude, good. We have fun. We're still looking for that win, but, today could be the day.
I remember yesterday talking to Brent Bookwalter and realizing, you know what? I haven't heard anyone say it, but you could win the race today, man. You know what? Same thing thinking about you right now. This is a race that is wide open. Opportunities come at the strangest of times. So you wake up this morning maybe thinking, Joe Lewis breakaway. That would work.
Yeah, well, there was a lot of time gaps yesterday, and I was in that gruppetto, so I'm no stress on anyone's overall ambition. So we'll see if I can't get up the road.
That'd be fun to watch, for sure. I guess we'll let you prove it with the legs. Tell me about your opinion of Morro Bay, coming from Australia. Are you a Gold Coast guy?
I am not a Gold Coast guy. I'm from a bit further down south.
So when you look at something like this, we are so proud in America of our California coastline. I think you can see why, right?
Yeah, almost. If I can get through the fog a little bit, I'm sure it's beautiful back there.
Thanks, Joe. Joe Lewis of the Holowesco Citadel team. Watch for him in the breakaway today. And, hey, Chris, good morning. Good job yesterday. You know, for some of our young riders, and Chris, you're, I believe, 22 years old now?
Yeah, that's right.
So for some of the younger riders in their first Amgen Tour of California, yesterday, I'm going to guess, was a pretty daunting stage. And you had a lot of work to do for Lachlan Morton. How'd it go for you, Chris?
It was good. It was definitely a tough day. Started out a little easy, which was great, because the day before was a really fast start. But as soon as we got close to Gibraltar, it got pretty chaotic and... there's a couple crashes which slowed me and a couple of the other guys down, but luckily Lockie got through it safe and was able to do a good ride still.
Yeah, we saw a video of you doing some pretty nifty bike maneuvering there to get around the crash that took out Kenog with the collarbone.
Yeah, that was just, it's one of those things where it happens in slow motion and you just do what you can to save yourself. And I got lucky I didn't go down, so yeah, that was nice.
Some other riders on the team going to be taking more responsibility today. I know you're there for Lachlan when the climbing is happening. It looks like tomorrow is going to be another big day, but today's a little different, isn't it? Maybe we see Ben Wolf in a breakaway for you guys.
Yeah, I think everyone but Lachlan will try and get in that early move, and then whoever's not there will be there just kind of getting him water, getting him bottles, keeping him out of the wind, because I think with it being on the coast all day, there'll be a bit of a crosswind like pretty much the entire ride to Laguna Seca, so that'll be really important to just kind of keep him sheltered.
Well, right on, Chris. Good luck out there. Hope it goes your way. That's Chris Putt of the Jelly Belly team. Let's grab a word with Phil Guymon. Phil, your cookie people were all over the climb. Good marketing yesterday for your Gran Fondo coming up later in the year.
Cookie Corner did not disappoint. No.
And we looked a great job, by the way. You really rode like a boss at the front. And it looked like Brad was saying, he's trying to get up to Cookie Corner first. He wants to be on the front of the group.
That was part of the goal. My first goal was to do my job, and I really did want to make it to Cookie Corner, and I blew up like 500 meters short.
Well, hey, I think Rowan was looking for Vegemite Corner out there, and we never saw it. So, hey,
there was a Vegemite Corner after the descent on the way. You didn't see that?
Well, yeah. So, hey, one of these great days of racing for sure. Yeah, as a California guy now, nothing quite like a climb like that. Any comments from the other riders after the race? Whoa, kind of thing?
You would catch them, maybe not on Gibraltar. Everyone was grumpy on Gibraltar. But, like, going down Mulholland the first time you see the ocean, everyone was like, you're kind of looking in the pack, and you're kind of looking over at the view, too.
Well, right on, Phil. And, hey, for people, I'm sure there's plenty here that want to, tell me what's a website to go to. Phil's going to have a bike ride that's going to be an incredible amount of fun, and we would certainly love to have you join us. So how do they get the info?
philsfondo.com. It's the Malibu Grand Cookie Dough. It's like a Grand Fondo, but it's cool.
All right. Thanks, Phil. That's Phil Guymon. Wow, what a character that guy is, Rowan, huh?
Yeah, you always get a little bit of a laugh out of him.
Yeah, no, and I think that's the thing. I love seeing you guys smiling. This is a tough race, no doubt about it. Yesterday looked brutal out there. How'd your day go?
It was good until the last about 2K when they really started to attack. So obviously it was Lockie and Stettner. They went early, but I thought, okay, relax. But that steep section, 2K to go, really killed our legs.
So you won on Diablo. How would you compare those two climbs?
Diablo, you get about a 2K section that you can actually recover on somewhat. There's no such thing on Gibraltar. But you got these two little flat downhill section, but downhill section was pretty short on Gibraltar, and it almost hurt the legs more than anything.
Yeah, are you guys picking up on the spectators on the side of the road? Looks like a lot of enthusiasm out there. We saw the Pope. We saw these crazy Phil cookies. Anybody catch your eye?
The cookies actually did. I saw those.
Did you try to eat one?
No, they had big bites out of them. They were a bit big for me. But, it's good to have the crowd out there, obviously. I got a cheeky push at about 1.5K. I didn't actually ask for it, but he gave it to me anyway. I think that probably helped me about a second or so. So that, thanks for that, whoever that was. It's always a good atmosphere on the climbs, and we appreciate it a lot.
Thanks, Ron. And you know what? If you're getting a push, let's assume the other guys are getting pushes too. It looked fantastic. So now the time trial on Friday. That's got to be what's laying on your mind.
Yeah, obviously I lost some time yesterday, 58 seconds down. So look, I've got some ground to make up on Folsom time trial, and it's going to be a hard task. But we still have 2 days of racing, so I think Alaphilippe is in great form. He is here for the GC, and today's going to suit him really well, and tomorrow's a lot of climbing. So just staying out of trouble, keeping as fresh as possible for that time trial to really attack it is my plan.
Rowan, you're still in the fight, man. This is going to be a great race.
It will be. It still is.
Yeah, absolutely. Rowan Dennis, ladies and gentlemen, former world hour record holder, fastest ever time trial of Tour of California. You know, it is amazing to me the quality of human beings we've got in the peloton these days. This is Travis McCabe of the Holowesco Citadel team. I just got to talk to three and another great rider coming up, Travis. Great time to be an American Cycling fan, isn't it? There's so many characters in this sport.
Oh, yeah, totally. I mean, this is continuing to grow, and you're seeing all the guys just being phenomenal riders and people, so it's great.
So Brad and I have to be completely fair. There's going to be some riders that just as a human being you pull for, and for us, Travis is one of them. And I had a chance to see Travis yesterday, stay in the same hotel, asking you about, come on, Travis, we know you're going to be good for the final stage. And you said, no, watch out tomorrow. And I thought to myself, wow, good. This should make things even more interesting. You believe you're in with a shot today.
Oh, yeah, totally. I mean, I've been making it over the climbs. These punchy little climbs that are towards the end there. I mean, that big cat, too, is going to be tough. But if I can make it over that, I think I have a good chance of winning, and I'm for it.
Absolutely. I'd expect you to go for it. And I hear Bobby Julich is working with the team here as well, Olympic bronze medalist. He was on the podium at the Tour de France. Extra advice and motivation on Holowesco Citadel today.
Yeah, Bobby's been great. I mean, him and George is here too. So we have both those guys today just kind of keeping us calm, making sure we're saving energy. And really what they're doing is just, you know, keeping us level-headed and not trying to get, like, it's easy to get really anxious for these big races, and so they've been doing a great job of just keeping us calm, making us focus on the race ahead, and it's been fun. It's been good.
We talk about, you know, the World Tour teams, the highest level, but it seems to me like you're on World Tour equipment. You've got World Tour legs. You've got World Tour brains behind you. Let's do this.
Yeah, that's it right there.
Right on, Travis. That's Travis McCabe of the Jalisco Citadel team. That's a kid who punches above his weight out of Arizona. This guy's been punching above his weight since day number one, Brent Bookwalter. Brent, you know, I'm sure you got a lot of things going on in the morning, but I enjoyed our talk yesterday. And I think one of the things I said is, dude, I might not hear a lot of people saying it, but I think you can win today. And I think you said, yeah, Dave, I think I can too. And you sure proved that I was right.
Yeah, I wanted it. A little off the mark there at the end, but I think I was maybe the first guy up at that mountain that weighed around, you know, 155 pounds as opposed to 135. So
the Clydesdale group now here at the Amgen Tour.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, one of the big guys. But yeah, we did a pretty good climb. Our team was really strong, and we're ready for these next 5 days.
And I'm not giving it lip service. This race is so far from over. I mean, you know, today, not pivotal, could be, though. Certainly tomorrow is, and then the day after that, the time trial. So don't kid yourselves. This thing has not even close to over. Am I right with that?
Yeah, we're just getting started. I mean, we're 3 days down of eight, and every day here can be decisive. You know, myself as a GC rider, I've had some good success in the past. You know, gaining seconds in kind of strange places here and there. So we'll be looking to do that again.
We're going to be watching. Brent Bookwalter of the BMC team. Now we've got Nielsen Powell, Greg Daniel now. Man, with the glasses and the helmet and the, like, looks exactly like Barta.
We're renaming the breakaway from cancer jersey the Action Hoggins-Berman jersey.
Well, that would be,
because they just keep,
well,
they're
right,
just trading it around the bus.
Well, Gregory Daniel, nice job yesterday. You get your turn in the jersey now. Seems like a rite of passage if you're on the Action Hoggins-Berman team. You're going to spend some time in this jersey. Tell me about how you did it yesterday. Where was where did you really shine?
Well, I think we've all been aggressive throughout this race, and yesterday Chris and I were in the break, and I think we raced it well at the end. I mean, when the break started attacking each other, we really applied our numbers and were able to get off the front, and I had good legs at the end and was able to keep going, and not quite as fast as the guys behind, but I think it was a good try, and maybe today is a better stage to go for it.
Hey, you and Tanner Putt used to be teammates as well. Looked like you guys were riding really well together out there.
Yeah, it's always really nice to race with Tanner. It was cool to be with him, and we know each other's strengths and weaknesses. And and I honestly didn't care like which one of us was going to get to the top of the climb first. I was just like, well, we can just work together. And I think he was kind of fading near the end, but I think we both had a good ride. And I'm looking forward to today.
And how old are you now?
21.
21 years old in our Amgen Breakaway from Cancer Most Courageous Riders jersey. This is Gregory Daniel. What a ride for Gregory yesterday. Thank you, my man. Wow. Very impressive job by Action every day at this race. And as we anticipated, here it is, your steady stream of riders coming in now. As Brad, we're getting pretty close to our 9:55 start here today because of television and wanting to get the race in its entirety on. And let's grab a word, though, with this man. Here he is, the revelation of the 2016 American cycling season. This is your SRAM Best Young Rider out of California. He's one of your own, Nielsen Paulus. And actually, Allison and Nielsen share the same hometown. He went to the same high school. Wow. Oh, my gosh, Nielsen says. So, well, Nielsen, I'm going to tell you one thing, young man. There are a lot of people talking about the ride that you put together yesterday. You're going to be spending enough time on this podium and stage that you'll get to know Allison and Joanna very, very well as time goes on. Talk to me about how hard it was to fall asleep last night after such a great ride.
Yeah, it was pretty great. I mean, it was definitely a really good feeling. But, it's a long race and I have to rest, so I didn't have too much trouble falling asleep.
So, hey, we met you going back to Santa Rosa. We had a press conference for this event. At that time, did you even know that you would be racing here?
I was doubtful. But after the spring season I had, it started to turn around. And then slowly but surely, eventually made the team. It was great.
So I see people like National Team Director for U23 athletes, Mike Sayers, talking about how proud he is of the 916 area code. And certainly there's obviously in your area in Northern California a lot of excitement about your ride right now. It's got to be nice to see those guys picking up on what you're putting down.
Yeah, it's great. I mean, I've known Mike for years especially, and you know, he's always believed in me, and he's always given me a chance, and thankful to him for that. So, it's been a great run so far.
Hey, our friends at SRAM have been tremendously supportive of this event. You ride on SRAM stuff. Got to be nice to be in the jersey today for a few reasons.
Oh, yeah, man. I mean, it's great equipment. It's really really nice to ride on. It looks nice. It feels nice, and, it's great. No conflicting sponsors on this on this jersey, so it works out. It's good.
This is working pretty perfectly. You look like the SRAM poster boy. Now, Nielsen, you keep it up. Looking at today's race, we talked so much about the battle yesterday. Going to be a little different out there today, isn't it?
Yeah, it's going to be a long one. The finish looks particularly hard. I think our team is really strong here, and I'm feeling good. So hopefully, success can continue.
I'm sure it will, my man. That's Nielsen Paulus. This is a big star in the making. Brad, we're going to need to move right into our rider introductions here. So we'll get the music fired up and introduce to you the top riders from around the world here at the Amgen Tour of California.
The final riders making their check-in now as we are inside of 10 minutes to the start of stage 4. That means it's time to start calling our big stars to the line.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to stage 4 of the Amgen Tour of California as we get ready to hit out for Monterey's Laguna Seca Racetrack, 135 miles of racing here today.